Well, greetings and salutations. My name is Seldon, screen name, and Access and Analyze 1942 online. The purpose of these videos is to show some platinum level strategies and ways to have some consistent victories in the game. As you see, top 10 platinum with allies in season 6. 17 games, 16 wins, 1 loss, 94% win rate. With Axis, 15 wins, 1 loss. I probably would have ranked higher, but I just needed to play more games. The algorithm does force you to play some more games to go a little higher up. But generally, as you see, I don't lose games. We're going to have a look at some higher level strategies. So this is probably aimed to players who are in gold or lower platinum level. I really enjoy this game. It's Access Now is 1942 online. It's a beautiful game. It's really 22nd century chess, 21st century chess. It's can get incredibly detailed in terms of strategy and tactics. I started playing when I was a little boy, Axis and Allies Classic, the board game. Playing with my dad, and then I ended up playing a lot with one of the other players online here, Zygmunt. Very good player. Yeah, it's a beautiful game. I'm going to show you, take you through one of the games. I'll just start it off. This is season 7 now, so I'm 0 games so far. So this is a placement game, playing against General 10. So let's have a look. And I'll just have some discussion as we go through, and we can look at the strategy that you can use to pretty much consistently win the game. I used to always play Axis. I'm playing some allied games now a little bit more. It's probably the preference. Generally speaking, if we're going to talk about the meta game, allies have the advantage after about round 9 when you're doing high level platinum play, is my experience. Early on, the very early rounds, sort of up to, especially when we get to about round 6, 7, 8, if Germany and the Axis can press their advantages, they've probably got the advantage until then. But the Allied production capacity, if they can just hold their ground until about round 9, 10, 11, it starts to get harder and harder for the Axis, generally if you're playing some very high-level players. Let's talk about some very overall strategy that we're going to do. You are required, really, in the high-level games to do a shuck-shuck strategy from Canada. If you don't know what that is, very famous old strategy papers. Don Ray, this is related to the original version of the game, but it carries through. And you want to go on, read his assets, essays. This is if you're a gold level player, silver level player, have a read of his essays. It starts to take you beyond the movement and the general rules. donessays.freeservice.com/essay1.htm. And that'll take you through some basic strategy and general thoughts about how you play the game. Very good strategy in there. Again, it's to do with the older version of the game. That's a very sensible play. Very sensible strategy. So the general game will generally look like this. Russia will be doing everything it possibly can simply to hold on. And that means holding Moscow and the Caucasus as long as possible. Moscow for good. There will be some games where Moscow will be lost and bounce back, but generally speaking, we'd want to try and hold Moscow. Germany will be obviously trying to capture Moscow, Caucasus and Moscow, as soon as possible. The way they can do that, if Russia is well supplied by their colleagues, UK and the US, the way that the Axis can do this is via Japan, pressing Moscow as quickly as possible. TDG, I think, has got some good sort of intermediate or higher level strategy videos to watch on this as well. Very good videos. And he's of the view, and I think it's correct, is that I generally like putting pressure through Yunnan and up through here towards Moscow as quickly as possible. TTG takes the view, and I think he's correct, that in many games India is a diversion. If you can capture it quickly and easily, that's good. Generally speaking, we want to put as much pressure on Moscow with Japan as possible. So generally speaking, overall strategy, Russia will contract as quickly as possible, simply to hold, because a very good Axis player will be able to take Russia if Russia does not contract. And that means pulling these units back as quickly as possible, letting Japan take some ground, pushing back just where necessary. And we're going to be defending Russia as quickly as possible with UK units. And we're going to do a shuck-shuck strategy. And this is where the overall long-term victory will come, will be from the US amphibious landings. There's two ways to do it. Some players like going into the Mediterranean. I'm a fan of the Finland-Norway shuck, simply because it does a couple of things. You can certainly come down into the Mediterranean quite effectively and be ensuring that Germany doesn't make too many inroads into Africa as a bit of an objective, but also to take Italy and take in southern Europe on a regular basis. And that's nice, but my preference is to do the shuck up here. And by shuck I mean we have round one, we create the units in eastern USA, and then we move them up to eastern Canada, and our ships will generally be based sort of here. Or if there's some risk from, say, Japanese submarines or bombers, say a bomber in France can strike this zone, but can't strike zone one. So we'll put our US ships in zone, usually zone 10, but sometimes zone one if extra protection is needed. And we'll just, one turn, they'll go to zone three, and they'll land them in Finland. Next turn, they'll come back. Back and forward, back and forward. And you often, at the end of the game, or near the end of the game, we might have five or six transports every turn, just dumping 10 or 11 troops here. Big failure that, and then it's just a matter of seeing who can win. The main mistake that a lot of players take is thinking that this is primarily a military game. It certainly is a military game, but I think primarily my strategy is that it is primarily an economic game. Consider this. Germany, if it say is doing well and has an IPC of say 45, means that they can create 10 units in Germany each time, 3 in Italy, and another 2 if they capture and hold Karelia, 15 units. And they'll be doing well to build focus a large amount of the resources on infantry. Consider this though. So if they're producing 15 units, if consistently every turn Russia's producing, say, 7 units, UK's producing 8 units, we already have 15. Okay, so we've counterbalanced the German numbers here. And then if we're regularly building another 12 units from the US, it's only a matter of time until the economic might of the Allies will cripple the German and Japanese offensive. Think of it in terms of how many units we're adding to the battlefield each turn, how many the enemy is producing, and then what we generally want to do is we want to create battles that, if your allies, neutral battles are okay, or preferably battles where you're going having an IPC advantage at the end of the battle. Alright, with that in mind, let's create some Russian units. I'm generally not opposed to having three artillery and four infantry. We'll need the artillery at some stage. But let's talk about the ratio of infantry and artillery. Some people do two infantry for one artillery. That's okay. It has some advantages, and especially if you think that you're going to be losing a lot of infantry, that probably makes sense. If you're on an offensive battle, it's nice if you do the units, just pull up one of the calculators and do battles of several hundred units. You'd like to see a ratio of three infantry to two artillery, but actually give you the best odds in an offensive position. Obviously, if you're defensive, you want more infantry and less artillery. But we're going to hope that we're going to be doing pretty well. So I'll do four infantry and three artillery. There's a couple of ways you can do this. What I want to do is generally have battles with an IPC advantage. I don't really care whether or not I actually win all the battles. The overall economic strategy dictates that we will still win the game. So if we're producing 20, 25 units, and Germany's only producing 15, we will eventually win. So the overall strategy actually becomes just to simply hold the line until those units can hit the front lines. That being the case, this is a huge risk. West Russia is a huge risk to Moscow because tanks can even blitz through, and there's a risk that they could sacrifice aircraft and things just to take to get a tank into Moscow. It's also for some reasonably juicy targets, and it'd be nice to hit this. This one is particularly juicy. We really want to kill the bomber and the fighter. Let's start off by putting everything we can into the Ukraine. So that's every single unit that can make the Ukraine will be going into the Ukraine. Let's now put every single unit that we can get that's left into West Russia. We're not going to bother about Karelia. Most probably it's a lost cause. So we end up having 12 units striking West Russia, 9 into Ukraine. We're going to ignore this. The Japanese forces are a real diversion. We really need to get out of there. Okay. And again, I don't care overly much how these battles go. It'd be nice to have a victory, but we will still win if we can hold the line. Let's do the Ukraine battle first, because it might decide how we play West Russia. choose that first. So four hits. Not too bad. And he's well chosen to lose the bomber first because it's a lost cause. Let's see how he fires back. He hasn't done particularly well. I've killed a bomber and three troops. This is right on a borderline of whether I retreat, and in fact I think I might. I've lost two troops to their three troops and a bomber, so it's a very good battle. If I fight on, the likelihood is I'll destroy all their troops and I'll be left with probably three tanks sitting in Ukraine. I don't want that, because they'll get destroyed. I'm thinking about the battle that comes after this battle. I'm now going to retreat. I've lost 6, they've lost 21. That's a good battle. I've gone to West Russia. Look at these beautiful odds. Why do we want to attack with overwhelming firepower? If we attack with overwhelming firepower, we could potentially destroy the entire enemy army in one round. They are then shooting back only one shot for each of their troops. So think about it. If they only get one shot back at us, they'll be hitting with these ones one out of three times. You know, they need a two or one to hit. That's six dice. So they'll be hitting a third of the time with these. So potentially I'm hitting, destroying three times as many. Obviously, depends on us rolling well here. Destroyed four of them. Let's see how they go. They've hit two. That's fine. We want to take that. This is a must win. Unlike Ukraine, we have to take West Russia. So we'll destroy them this round. If we're lucky, if we destroy them all, he wouldn't be shooting back. Unfortunately, he's now got a good chance of killing one of my units. And he does. But still, overall, it's a successful battle. We've lost 9, they've lost 19. This is the key thing to look at. Minus 15 on our side, minus 40. Germany can't sustain this. Non-combat move. We will put our submarine there, obviously. Right, us with some support. This troop will go down here because this is a little bit of a tempting target from an IPC perspective for the Japanese, but this makes it a lot harder. This troop here will go to there. These two will go for here for the counterpunch. And we possibly will have a counterpunch because remember we still have three tanks here, plus we'll be able to hit it with two infantry and a whole lot of infantry that are sitting in West Russia. This isn't a bad move too, having one fighter here. It means that there's a chance, or some threat, that we could hit this Japanese unit when it comes into Manchuria. Whatever this one's called. Buratia. general strategy is that we must hold Russia at all cost. We're contracting. Now, we can expand again later on, but for now, we're contracting. Everything comes back. Some people leave one in here. I know TTG, I believe, does a little. Some players do. That's fine. Overall, I find the risk here is especially a fighter up in Archangel, Arkhangelsk. If they come here, there's a risk now. He's got to hold this fairly strong, or I could actually take it back. One, two, one, one, two, three, four. So I could take, if he tries to take Buryatia with his Manchurian troops. He's going to actually do it quite strongly, because I can come in here with four units and a fighter. He might even have to move all three up there, which is a long way around. By building the three artillery, which I can put here as well, puts a very strong counterpunch if he tries to hold or move into Ukraine. So we're going to do that. Don't neglect these. These guys are quite useful. Let's see what he can attack West Russia with, because we didn't clean all of these up, remember. He can attack with three infantry, an artillery, tank, tank, tank. So three, four, five. Just count up the number of units. Three, four, five, six, seven, eight. Plus aircraft, 9, 10, 11. So he can certainly do that. And we've only got 6, 7, 8, 9. Let's make it more less tempting to put an aircraft in here. Let's do that. And let's just check what he can attack here with. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Attack here 7. And what have I got here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So I think he'd be fairly silly to go in there with that number of units. 1, 2, the very high value units. 1, 2, 3, tanks, and artillery. 1, 2. Yeah. So in fact, what we might do is move this fighter. Actually, we can't. We just captured it there. And we could possibly. We've got a similar number of. I don't want to give him a clear advantage, because then we run into that trouble if he's clearing off many more troops than I have in his first round, and I'm not firing back with a whole lot. So the IPC advantage goes to him, but I don't think that's the case. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Yeah, 1, 2, 3. Can attack with that one as well. 10. Yeah, it is quite a large battle, but what I'll probably do then is I might actually move him there. Just makes it a little less attractive. Just second guess that. We're not going to do that. I think he'll be silly. He'll lose. He'll be sitting there with a couple of tanks, and I'll just get destroyed by my units. So you've got to think about a couple of battles ahead. He can certainly do that. He'd get an IPC victory, probably in taking IPC advantage in the battle, taking West Russia, but the battle afterwards, he's going to have a whole lot of very high-value units that'll just be cleaned up. So that's generally what we're looking at with Russia. place our units. And I want to have a lot of heavy firepower as close as possible on the front lines. So I'm going to put his artillery there. Because he might decide to pour a whole lot of units into here. Of them in Russia. So we've got a good counterpunch. That's the aim. We want to make it really unattractive for him to take this one. He possibly could go for West Russia here, but he's losing. What would he lose? I'll hit probably two from that, one from that, possibly four. So he'll be sitting here with a couple of tanks, which you just lose immediately. This one is probably not possible for him to take. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Yeah. 7A. That's a silly battle for him to take. So the West Russia he could very well take. But it would be costly. He might lose a fighter to the AA. And he'd lose probably 3 or 4 units here, leaving just some high-value targets that'll just get picked off straight away. We're going to let Karelia just go. He can't blitz through Karelia because the factory stops the blitz. And we've got a reasonable counterpunch into Karelia if he tries to take it lightly. I've got 2 units here, 6 there, so 8 units, 8 infantry in total, a couple of artillery, potentially 4 tanks, which is one of the nice reasons why we want to bounce back. So I'm pretty satisfied with that. Had some reasonably good rolling here in West Russia. But my general thought is don't despair if these rolls go bad. Overall, if Russia can hold the line, which is the key job that Russia has, they're in a pretty strong position. Germany can also, in some battles that I used to do, Germany sometimes goes into Africa. My view is Africa is a little bit of a lost cause for Germany. The US can get troops into Africa in one turn from the East Coast. Right? So, overall, with a competent Allied player, Germany's never really going to be able to hold it, make a serious play into Africa with a competent Allied player. So the better strategy might be to use this into an attack or a kamikaze attack into the Caucasus. Probably won't last too long anyway, that transport. We'll see what he does. But you can do a couple of troops into Caucasus from there. So what would that be? That would be, say, 2 from here with a battleship in support, say 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. About 10 units can easily get there. But I've already got 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. It's not going to be a very good battle from the Germans' perspective. And they may again also just, if you lose an aircraft or 2 straight off the bat from the AA gun, you're in a very bad position there. Losing some very high-value units. So I don't think they'll do that. They could very well try for a play into West Russia, but again, they'll be left with some high-value units. So I'm more interested in the battle after the battle that's to come. So try and think a battle or two ahead, and you're in a good position. So we'll see what moves they make. If I was Germany at this point in time, what I'd be doing generally is probably moving to consolidate in Karelia. If they can get fast enough into Karelia. What they want to do as Germany is create a pin. In chess we would call it a pin between a couple of pieces that you want to threaten at the same time. And West Russia is a real key here. So if you can get a good number of units into West Russia, Germany often must retreat into Russia, leaving Caucasus open, because you're threatening both. Russia often can't defend both at the same time, and so they must withdraw. into Moscow. Defenders always had the advantage in Axis and Allies because infantry units defended at 2 but only attack at a 1. So you often find a large stack here and a large stack here. Even if the large stack in Moscow is larger than the German stack, say, in West Russia, the German stack still may be very safe because the Russian attackers are only attacking at 1. But the Russians can't defend 2 at the same time, so they might have to pull back. You can march into the Caucasus. And if it's a 50-50 battle, you can often then move some Japanese fighter planes into the Caucasus or into West Russia if you have to as well, remembering that the order of play is Russia, Germany, and then Japan gets a go before Russia turns Russia's next turn. So if Germany captures the territory, the Japanese can reinforce it with aircraft before Russia get to play again. And that means that even if Germany is on not super solid ground, the Japanese Air Force can often consolidate and protect it and put those units in a much healthier position and make them immune from attack. Germany taking Caucasus is sometimes a mixed blessing because often Germany is under a lot of pressure. There's a couple of overall strategies that are sometimes used by the Allied powers. There's either what some people call the kill Germany first, or KGF strategy, which means basically pouring everything you can into Germany. Or there's the KJF strategy, kill Japan first strategy. High-level players mostly seem to prefer kill Germany first. Kill Japan first just simply seems to take too much time. It's very possible, but it takes a long time. And usually by the time that Japan's under a lot of pressure, Moscow may have fallen. The strategy is Japan to defeat the kill Japan first strategy is usually this. As soon as you notice that it seems to be a kill Japan first strategy, if Japan focuses on Navy, in particular submarines are a good one, then they can usually swat it away quite easily. The submarine is a very good offensive unit and effective at stopping a kill Japan first strategy, if you catch it in the first round especially. So once you see America putting down a whole lot of units. But I'm not really a fan of either kill Germany first or kill Japan first as strategies. In any very high-level games, the whole world is a battlefield. Just remember that. If the whole world is a battlefield, let's stop looking at kill Japan first or kill Germany first as an overall strategy. And I like to look at let's maximize all of the battles. Inevitably, even with the kill Germany first strategy, inevitably, after about round 7 or 8 or 9, I'll be fighting Japanese units over here anyway, right? This is a worldwide battlefield. So I think it's a fairly narrow-minded to talk about just a kill Japan first or a kill Germany first strategy. The whole world is a battlefield. Let's remember my first principle. This is primarily an economic game. So let's cause as much damage wherever it exists, wherever the theatre lets us cause the most damage to the opposition. Let's do it. And then inevitably, the less units that we're going to be facing anyway, we'll be facing those units anyway, whether they're on the eastern or the western flank of Moscow, which is where the primary battle. Control of the centre will control the game, which is Moscow and Caucasus and so forth. us cause as much damage as we possibly can to the enemy, wherever in the world that damage could occur. So I see a lot of troubles with the kill Germany first strategy, as some players do it. Sometimes they pull their entire navy through the Panama Canal, and they dump a vast Allied navy somewhere here off the UK. That's all well and good, but often if Germany only has an air force of 5 or 6 fighters, I honestly don't need numerous battleships and aircraft carriers, and I don't need 12 ships to defend against 5 or 6. I would be much better employed in harassing the Japanese down here somewhere and taking strategic or tactical victories where I can get them, causing as much damage and distraction to the Japanese fleet as I possibly can. Think of it this way. If I can simply, by leaving some of these ships here, if I can distract Japan even by 1 or 2 turns from its efforts against Moscow, that'll have tremendous strategic advantage to me. And I'm often surprised how effective it is just to keep one transport over here and a couple of ships over here, and you can take, if you come down here especially to the Solomons, you can threaten a vast amount of Japanese resources in the Money Islands. East Indies, 4 points. Borneo, 4 points. Philippines, 3 points. That's 4, 8, 11 points of Japanese production. If I can even threaten those, even if I can't necessarily take them or hold them, if I'm diverting Japanese, if Japanese are having to build ships and divert their navy over here and divert their transports over here, even better, I've done a tremendous service. Those couple of ships that would have just sat as extra navy over here, it's not even required, have now delayed potentially 6, 7, 8 troops from advancing on Moscow. And I've had some battles, sometimes you're lucky too. A bad Japanese play up here means you can even just hold on to one of these islands for a couple of turns. And the amount of resources that Japan requires to take those back can often be significant. Similarly, this British fleet here can sometimes join up with this, and even without creating a whole lot more American vessels, because I don't want to spend too much over here, I want to still focus primarily on Germany, but if I can, without much effort, start to put a bit of pressure down here, it's incredible to see somehow the whole Japanese war machine starts to divert away from where it's needed against Moscow. It starts to buy the distraction. But it's not really a gambit, because interestingly, if Japan fails to do that, often the Allies can cause tremendous damage down here. So they're damned if they do and damned if they don't. If Japan ignores it, the Allies cause tremendous damage. But if they respond, they're diverting significant resources away from Moscow. I generally devote about 90% to Germany, and about 10% of resources. Just 10% of resources down here can cause catastrophic damage to the Axis battle plan. That typically means you do need, if you're going to threaten the Money Islands, you do need a transport to do that. There's no IPCs in the sea, remember. The only IPCs are on the islands, and we want to threaten these islands here. And sometimes you can come through and cause them some tremendous difficulties over here. The other advantage in maintaining a little bit of a navy over here is you can often hold on to Hawaii, which is nice. You have to be very watchful of the Japanese strategy, quickly takes Karelia, quickly takes India, and then quickly takes Hawaii. That'll get them to the IPCs that they require for victory. 9 out of 9 IPCs, that's all they need to do, just take those three. And all are eminently possible to take, even by about, I've won a few games even in round 3 and round 4. Just by quickly snagging Karelia, diving everything I can into India, if I'm playing Axis, and one little sneaky transport, taking Hawaii. And if the Americans have diverted the entire fleet over here, there's nothing they can do about it. So let's stop thinking about it as a kill Japan first or a kill Germany first strategy. Let's realize that this game is what it is, which is a global battlefield. Whether we're fighting Germany right now or Japan right now, we're inevitably going to be beating those units at some stage, by about round 7 or 8 anyway, and I prefer to be simply dealing the most effective battles through the game as we possibly can. And again, I don't need 12 or 13, 14 aircraft. And some players build a aircraft carrier in the US. I'm not a fan of that. I'd much prefer to have troops on the ground rather than aircraft carrier sitting there, superfluous to needs, especially if the Germans can't, have got no way to destroy it anyway, whatever's there anyway. We can combine the British and the American fleets, often up in about Sea Zone 3 here, and they're very hard for the Germans to get. If they start building a whole lot of aircraft, what I often do is just, I can bring the fleet down to, say, one of the British sea zones, and the British in their turn can, so if I see, for example, Germany building a whole lot of aircraft to try and take out the Navy, then in the British turn, I can build a whole lot of ships on one of these sea zones, bring the fleets down, join it up with the US fleet, and again, they're safe. And I've done the job for them. They've done their purpose. They've fulfilled their purpose, which is to distract Germany. If they are going to take a 50-50 battle against a British fleet, now I will always, and you'll see this, no matter what's going to happen now, how successful Germany is at beating this, I'll always build a British fleet in round 2. Simply because I welcome Germany destroying the Luftwaffe, or trading the Luftwaffe against a British fleet. Yeah, there's probably no quicker way to whittle down the German air forces than have it destroy a whole lot of the British fleet here. And if I lose some points, they've lost points as well. And remember, the key objective is to blunt their offensive. These are planes that they would have been using against Moscow. It's a very fast way. If I can build some troops down here and a fleet down here, even if it's a 50-50 battle, or even if they've got a 60-40 battle, probably even better, give them some reasonable odds, they might go for it. They've destroyed two or three, or they lose two or three German aircraft. Even if I've lost 40 IPCs and they've lost 30, that's fine by me. There's probably still no quicker way for me to reduce their combat power than that. So there's a couple of exceptions to the rule of wanting to always have IPC victories in battle. Remember, the overall strategy really is just to see if we can hold Russia as long as possible until the troops start pouring in from the US into Finland. And the exception would be, if I can blunt the offensive against Moscow, even if it's a little bit costly, provided it's not a horrible battle, very happy to do that. Because I know that if Moscow can hold long enough, we will win the game. A good Japanese player will start coming up through here. And Japan can do the same thing as Germany can. Germany can move into Western Russia and fork Moscow and the Caucasus. Japan can do the same through Kazakh, Fukin Fork, Russia, and Caucasus. So by sitting here, can be attacking either, and often Russians will need to move back to defend Moscow. It doesn't bother me too much if we even lose the Caucasus. Hopefully by that stage, the British are around here, and we'll be able to move in, and we can often save it. So again, if the Germans take the Caucasus, often the British can take it back the next turn, and Russia can produce again that next turn already, because they've held it since the start of Russia's turn. Germany, Britain, if Britain holds it, takes it back, and then because of the order of play. So if an ally can take it back in time, that doesn't concern me too much, because Russia can produce there again. So that's where we're at so far. And again, it doesn't really bother me too much if Japan takes India. It's a very long way through to Moscow from India. Usually they've burnt 3 or 4 or 5 turns to try and come into India. And then they often get caught up here in Persia. They can't really fork anything in Persia, so I just need to hold with some troops here, and it's usually quite strong. Mostly by about 8, you'll see by about 7 or 8, by around 7 or 8, there'll be a whole lot of troops sitting in, American troops either sitting in Finland, or hopefully they've been able to push the Germans back, and they're in Karelia. When we start to get into a position of trading between the Germans and the Allies, choose one power to trade with. You want to have one of the downsides of the Allies is that it's very easy to defend with the Allies, because all of the units will defend as one, right? So if I have 10 Russian, 10 UK, 10 American troops in West Russia, that's fine, that counts as 30 troops, beautiful, and it's very hard to block that. If I'm attacking as the Allies, those 10 troops will only attack 10 at a time against maybe, say 30 German units. It's not feasible. So what we want to do is have one of the powers that's as strong as possible. Russia will probably just be holding its own, probably by batting away the Japanese that are coming on this side. We need to try and blunt the Japanese as much as we can, perhaps by a bit of American fleet action in the Pacific. So the choice would really be to use either the Americans or the British to do most of the trading with, and then basically just stockpile the other nation's troops. So if you're using the, and I mostly trade with the British, and then the Americans, say if the British is successful, I can then often move all the American troops in there as one big clump. And that means that you've got a nice, fresh, large stack of Americans, and often there's very little number of British left, because I've been trading away like crazy with the Brits. But I've got a large stack of American troops. And that means at the end of the game, because they're fresh and they haven't been traded much, I'm coming up against Germany, often with a large stack of, 60, 70 or something American troops, maybe just 10 British troops, because I've been trading them like crazy. But that's fine, that's a lot nicer to be attacking with 60 or 70 troops rather than 30 British and then 30 UK, if that makes sense. You probably won't be using too many British troops, Russian troops in here. Maybe there'll be a few Russian troops here and there, and I like to help the Russians out by having the Russians maybe capture some of the easy territory where they're not going to be attacked back. Give the Russians as much IPC advantage as they can, because they'll need it against the Japanese. Yeah, other thing to keep in mind, we mostly will get our fighter supply. You can reach, from the east coast of the US, you can get to either Gibraltar or Morocco. Both have their advantages. So if there's a good number of German troops here, I often shuttle them down here. So some people shuttle the US aircraft, say, up to, you can get them up to, say, Greenland, and then maybe land them into Karelia. This one's nice, though, because I can get, if I get to Gibraltar or Morocco, they can often fight something down here in Africa. Or they can just land straight into the Caucasus, where they're often needed. That's often where a lot of the battle's happening down around the Caucasus. So I mostly shuttle my aircraft down here, and one of the advantages of that is you can often get quite a large number of American aircraft in Gibraltar or Northern Africa. Really, they're able to often, by about round two or three, I use them to actually knock out the German battleship and transport, if it hasn't already been done. The British are a little bit too valuable to use, I find. I know a lot of players use them to clear out these, but I prefer to use it's more expendable, the US aircraft. Okay, so we'll see what General 10 does. And then we'll come back and we'll talk through some options here. Generally speaking, you'll see that I'm going to shuck troops into Finland. It's nice to get a free two-pointer that Germany will never get back. You can do that either with Britain or with America, but I generally go with the UK. They generally need those extra couple of IPCs a little bit more. Yeah. So we'll come in there and do that. Generally speaking, you'll see me just build a British fleet here. If Germany wants to throw its planes against it, that's fine. That's just a whole lot less pressure on Russia then, if that happens. And I just rebuild it again straight away, so it's no big deal. And they can't keep doing that forever. That's a very fast way to get rid of some of the Luftwaffe. And then, although I do need to hold it reasonably, I need to hold it strong enough once, if I've got five transports in here, I need to start beefing it up a little bit sometimes, but usually by that stage, they've lost a couple of fighters, they're down to, say, three German fighters or four German fighters, and it's honestly not that hard to defend against that. Okay, well, let's see what they do. Let's see what General 10 does. And my guess is if I was General 10, I would be consolidating. Yeah, it's usually a mistake to take Karelia strongly in round one. He wants to take it lightly, for sure. Say one infantry. But if he goes in strong, he can probably get 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10... 11, 12, you can get about 12 in there, but I can attack with 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, he's in a world of pain if he goes in there. What the essays would say, that essay that I referenced earlier, would call, from Don Ray, would call a bit of a death zone. He can take it, but he'd be destroyed. So the smarter Axis move would be just to mass his troops, probably in Baltic states, and get what he can here, get those two units from Sweden, get them into here, ready for a much stronger offensive, which would be in round two. And it might be that Russia has to fall back and can't hold on from that. So Russia would probably be sensible to come back and again take it back lightly. But again, if Russia goes in strong, then Russia is destroyed. So you'll find a lot of this very light trading in high-level games, because you don't want to get smashed by the enemy. We just want to go for efficient, effective battles, where we end up with an IPC advantage at the end of the battle. And we don't want to have big, huge battles for the sake of having big, huge battles if the IPC advantage isn't there. And then we'll just start shucking over the American troops to the point that it gets unsustainable for the Axis. I'll have to start falling back. We want to try and hold a forward position, most forward position that we can effectively. Let me put it this way. If our major bulk of our armies is, say, in West Russia, and the Germans are, say, their main bulk of their army is, say, could be Ukraine, say, and we just got a bit of a stalemate here. Germany's actually not doing too badly out here, but if I can push them back, if I can get our troops, our front line, to be even, say, Belarusia, then what I'm doing every turn, I'm often light capturing all these extra territories over here, and they're having to spend units in getting them back, especially if I'm using, say, one sacrificial power to get them. So, say, UK is just spending its troops each turn to capture these off. Germany's losing a few here and there, but we're up an extra, say, four IPCs rather than if our front line was back here. We want to have our front line as sensibly possible, as sensibly advanced as we can, and it's won us an extra sort of consistent sort of four IPCs every single turn, and they're down a couple of IPCs, a few IPCs every single turn, so we want to do that. So it's a beautiful thing. There's a lot of deep strategy to Axis and Allies Online. It's a beautiful game. It reminds me very much of chess, especially at the highest levels. You'll see probably some very strategic withdrawals from time to time. So for example, in India, good players can often put a lot of pressure on India after about, round 3, 4, 5. You don't need to have a set piece battle then. What you can do is withdraw back to, say, Persia with all your troops, let them capture it, but often Japan actually can't capture India very strongly. They can have a huge big set piece battle there because they can often get a lot of aircraft in there. Remember, they can't land their aircraft in there to defend. So I've had many games where when it looks like Japan's about to take India, we just withdraw back to here. Yeah, they do take it, yes, but I just take it back straight away. Or even better, you can often take it, say, with a Russian tank, and then the British move back in and they can build again straight away, right? Because it's because of the turn order. Russia will take it before Britain's turn, and Britain can start producing in there straight away. All right, so a lot of these, again, you'll see, I might decide, often I decide to try and, whatever it will cause the most damage down here, if I can smash, then I'll, it's nice to get rid of some of these fighters. I mean, these fighters, a lot of people say, well, why are you doing KJF? Those fighters will be used against Russia in a round or two. Why not use my sometimes worthless or unused British fleet to try and smash this fleet here? It's a high value IPC fleet. This is about a 50-50 sort of battle. It's certainly by no means guaranteed, but if you pull it off, you've really caused some tremendous damage to the Japanese. If you lose out as Britain, well, this fleet probably wasn't going to do a whole lot anyway. These transports often just end up floating around, with the aircraft carrier. I've seen some games, high-level games, the aircraft carrier just sits around here somewhere and doesn't really accomplish much anyway, so why not use it? Let's find whatever battles we can and do it well, and sometimes you're really lucky in this one, and you end up with a really strong UK fleet sitting here, and you've smashed these couple of fighters, and Japan's really in a world of pain if that happens. They've got to start replenishing. And then what happens is you come down here, they assume you're going for a KJF, and all this IPC production starts going to a Navy for Japan. you can actually sometimes get them to use a couple of production turns in Japan to build up a navy. And all you really want to do then is just harass them, cause them IPC damage, take a couple of these islands maybe. They'll start pushing you back, and then you just move on. But they've just, meanwhile, they've spent a whole lot of, what could have been, it's often 12 or 15 troops coming at Moscow is now just sitting in a whole pile of worthless submarines off the Japanese coast. Remember, objective number one really must be for Moscow to hold. So whatever it takes for Moscow to hold, you want to accomplish. There have been some games where I've lost Moscow, but the only way that I've been able to do it is by basically I've been able to take Germany. And you can win. If you lose Moscow but you've won Germany, you'll still win. It just ends up in a long game. In fact, I had a 39 round game with Il Principino. Very good games. 39 rounds we went. And just to show you how it becomes a worldwide battle, that game, and around in the round 30s, ended up with a monumental battle in the US. I was playing the Allies, and it was saved by, and this is, mind you, we weren't trying to do anything crazy, but these were the best moves. The best moves ended up with a large Russian Air Force in, believe it or not, in central US. We had about 6 or 7 Russian fighter planes in central US, which actually turned the tide, and I was able to, he couldn't get beyond it. An enormous battle here, but had very, very strong Japan, but he had lost Germany. Japan was everywhere. He had lost Germany. Russia had held. So some very large armies were over here, but Russia had held. And I think when it was clear that Russia was going to hold, diverted to US, and it was very dicey for a while. Very good moves from Il Principino. Ended up in some monumental battles over here, and came very close to victory, but I was able to pull it off at the end, thanks to a large Russian air force here. So it's a worldwide theatre. I encourage you to stop thinking of it as a KJF or a KGF. Let's think about it as a worldwide theatre of battle. We want to stop Japan, even in a KGF. We want to threaten, and we want to divert resources that Japan will be sending to Russia, because they want to do a pincer against Moscow. Often coming through here and then try and take here. Ideally, they want Japan to take the Caucasus, but that's often not possible because Japan's trying to fend off the Allies. Usually, landing everywhere. They don't want to have to be spending, building 4 units in here. It'd be nice if it's Japan, but often that's not possible. Japan will be coming up as a pincer in here. We want to just be blunting that as much as possible. So anyway, that's enough speaking from me. We'll see when General Ten gets back online, and we'll see what he wants to do. But again, what I'll be doing is, I can already tell you at this stage, I'll be building the UK fleet no matter what. Always build some troops down here. They're very close to the action. It's nice to have a big UK force down there. But up here, so again, it's silly not to keep the Japanese in mind. And there'll be a fleet going in here. We'll be inviting Germany to try and smash it and lose some aircraft in the process. And then we'll just rebuild again the next round if they don't. And I do that even if we have a really disastrous one. I usually still do it. Occasionally, if it's very disastrous, I don't. Actually, Japan, Germany, the good German movers, actually to knock out this cruiser with a battleship. I mean, they can mess around down here. This destroyer is not going to help Britain much anyway in the near future, so I don't know why Germans always want to destroy that destroyer. Better move is often to use the battleship against this cruiser here. So you've knocked out one major element of the British fleet here. You can divert one of the submarines in here. You take a 50-50 against the destroyer. And if you have, basically you've knocked out a cruiser and a destroyer, and you've often still got the submarine sitting there. You've destroyed this entire fleet. And if you're lucky, and you've got an extra submarine and things there, a lot of British players, some of the UK players, won't build a fleet. Because they'll say, especially if then the Germans put their air force in a sensible location that can attack Sea Zone 7. That's usually France or Northwest Europe. If they put the German air force there, or Finland, Finland can hit it as well. 1, 2, 3, 4. A lot of players won't do it. They'll just say, well, okay, I can only put down 3 or 4 British Navy ships. And they can hit it with 5 German fighters. So it doesn't make sense for me to do it. However, I generally just do it anyway. If I can knock off a couple of German fighters, I'm pretty happy. Because again, the overall objective, let Russia hold. Russia is just that constant, right on the front line, they can pump out usually 6, 7, you know, sometimes 8 troops right on the front line. And if Germany takes it, their IPC advantage, you know, they can start diverting all their resources somewhere else. So, anyway, that's a lot of speaking. We'll come back and we'll see what General Ten does. And we'll see how we go. But generally speaking, with the strategy that I'll show you, it's very hard not to win. And I think, as I showed you from my stats, yeah, 15 wins, 1 loss, 93% win rate, 94% win rate. I suppose you'll always get a game or two where you have some computer issues or just those 1% battles or a couple of 1% battles in a row that go against you. But generally speaking, you want to get a 90 sort of plus percent win rate if you use the right strategy.